There's all of this virtue about a particular woman written in prose in chapter 31 at the end of the book of Proverbs is because Solomon's basically saying for a political leader, i.e. the king of the country, Rehoboam, you better choose wisely who your wife's going to be because she can help you or hurt you.
Thank you for joining us. This is the Capital Ministries Weekend with Ralph Drollinger. Ralph is president and founder of Capital Ministries. My name is Frank Sontag. Welcome. We would urge you, as we begin this study, to go to capmin.org and download not only this study, but any study. All the Bible studies are available online. You can follow as we go through. And this being Mother's Day weekend, happy Mother's Day to all you moms out there. Right, Ralph?
Yes, good to see you, Frank. Happy Mother's Day to your wife, Erin.
Thank you, and to yours, Danielle.
Amen. Thank you.
For all the moms listening, again, we applaud you, we celebrate you, and the Bible study is going to be very interesting in that when I tell you the name, 10 Characteristics of a Godly Woman, this not only applies to all women and men listening. So, Ralph, let's kind of get into 10 Characteristics of a Godly Woman. And first of all, share whatever comes to mind, and then I have a question right out of the gate that I think our listeners are going to be interested in asking.
Well, if people download the study from the CapMin website, and it's probably right up there on the homepage, we make that easy for you. This is the study that I'll be teaching this week in D.C. to the Senate member, House member, former White House cabinet, former White House senior staff, and governors. Zoom Bible studies will be going through this same copy. So people can download it and actually not only be personally edified by it, but as well pray for me and the dissemination of God's word on this particular issue timely this coming week. Having said that, where we go in the study this week is Proverbs 31. And Proverbs 31, in its tightest context, is Solomon, who's the king, right, of Israel, writing to his son Rehoboam, who'd be the next king. And so why there's all of this virtue about a particular woman written in prose in chapter 31 at the end of the book of Proverbs is because Solomon's basically saying for a political leader, i.e. the king of the country, Rehoboam, you better choose wisely who your wife's going to be because she can help you or hurt you. And actually, after I go through the 10 characteristics, Frank, as you looked at the study, we look at the 8 bad babes of the Bible. So we do a contrast relative to what every guy should be looking for and what every woman biblically should have as an aspiration to become. And then we take that thought of all the virtues of Proverbs 31 woman to a New Testament understanding of the same, which is probably the biggest passage in the New Testament parallel to Proverbs 31, is Titus chapter 2. Verses 3 through 5. And we'll get into that, and we can look at a bit of a contrast. Seemingly, if there's what we call the analogy of Scripture, there's no contradictions in Scripture, but seemingly we'll look in our time together today, Frank, at a little bit of a nuance of differentiation between supposedly what's said in Titus 2 and what Solomon's writing in Proverbs 31.
So for the average listener right now, that this is an enticing topic, if you will, I want to address the elephant in the room just for a brief moment. We have a way in which we live in our culture right now where there's even this debate about male, female, gender, and I'm not necessarily asking you to go down that road. But again, the Bible study, 10 characteristics of a godly woman, there's a certain clarification that I think I'm going to ask you to breathe deep into this, because what I see is so much of the confusion in culture, my view, is just that it's biblical illiteracy, yeah, not understanding what the Bible says about this.
Oh, yeah, and there's such a secularism today of trying to redefine what a female or a male is. There's certainly an effort to redefine. There is, in American law, that you're basically creating a construct of quicksand to build any thoughts. How could you possibly say 10 characteristics in a dogmatic sense of a godly woman if you don't even have a foundation for making such a point?
Right.
And so, like, recently New York had an earthquake, but all Manhattan's built on a rock, so the skyscrapers didn't topple. But if New York was built in quicksand, you wouldn't have any construct above that remains for very long. And so it is metaphorically with, I think, an answer to your question, with the male-female and marriage debacle with woke moralism, and you're changing all of those foundational truths to where you can't build anything that has any immutability to it.
And if I may also, the other one in my head is, and I'm just going to go bottom line here, there's probably some people listening, rare though in this audience, but if this was in secular culture, they would go, oh, there's another Christian moralist telling the women they got to stay home in the kitchen, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah. And that couldn't be further from the truth.
Yeah, well, we'll get into that as we look at what the Greek is in Titus chapter 2, where the older women are to teach the younger women in the church to be workers at home, is how most of the English translations put that. But we'll look at the Greek word under that, and we'll notice there's no preposition at. The word at that's supplied in the English translation that exists in the Greek word ergon oikos, which we'll get into more in a little bit.
You're listening to Capital Ministries Weekend with Ralph Trollinger. If you would like to follow along, Ralph will be teaching in D.C. this week, specifically this Bible study entitled 10 Characteristics of a Godly Woman. We thought it would be a timely study to delve into since this is Mother's Day weekend. Again, happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there. So, Ralph, let's get into your Bible study and any initial thoughts about whether it's the idea of working at home. You drew the parallel between Proverbs and Titus. Obviously, we've only got a few moments on the air to just briefly touch on your very deep and important Bible study.
So when you look at what Solomon's saying to Rehoboam about what he should be looking for in a virtuous, godly wife, this woman's all over the marketplace. There's no way around that. She's out of the home. She's creating all kinds of value for her family, for her husband, and for her children. And so she's a tradeswoman, if you will. And so you can't get around that exegetically when you study the Hebrew, that's original language that Proverbs 31 is written in. But then when you get to your point in our foreshadowing of Titus chapter 2, it says that the younger women are to be taught by the older women to be, in the English, workers at home. But again, the Greek word here is, it doesn't supply, the English translators have supplied, it's oikos ergos, which oikos, we get the word home from, and then oikos ergon. Ergon is basically the root for what we get ergonomics in English. It's pretty easy to translate that. And so it means energy. It means a worker. So when you put the two together, the literality here without the word at, which is supplied to make the English translations flow, is a bit misleading, because the word at tends to be a preposition that says geographically where the woman should be giving energy. The literality of the Greek is that she has energy for the home. And so in essence, the older women in the church are to teach the younger women to have energy, and you might say priority and precedent for the home. And so how she goes about that then synthesizes nicely with Proverbs 31, where she can be in the marketplace and she can be about industriousness in order to better build her home. But her priority is her home, but it doesn't mean she has to be at home all the time. And of course, some pastors, some churches, they'll preach that, like I know one church that says all the elders' wives can't have a job. They have to be workers at home. But again, that's supplied in the English translation, and I don't think you can really support it in the Greek.
Ralph Trollinger is here. This is the Capital Ministries Weekend with Ralph. 10 characteristics. I'm just going to jump around and anywhere you want to add in. You mentioned industriousness is one of the characteristics. She's prudent. She's wise and understanding. She's compassionate. She's classy. She's kind, valuable, trustworthy, and the like. When I read those characteristics on the air, there may be some women listening right now like, that's a lot of pressure. And yet, the other half is the problem. Do we get into that conversation at all? Is there anything?
Yeah, I think in terms of what we'd call progressive sanctification, that this is a list. This is a list for what a king's wife needs to be in its Titus context. And it's not necessarily a litmus test list for every guy that gets married. And no one's going to find the perfect wife, which is really supplied here in Proverbs 31. You're not going to find this woman no matter how hard you look. So she's an ideal. She's a North Star. And so we all want to find that woman as a male. And as a woman listening, you want to become this woman. But in the sense of progressive sanctification, it's never going to be totally achievable given our sin nature, our fallen nature. And we won't be a perfect male or female until we get glorified in heaven. And so the idea here is we don't foist this on you as kind of a legalistic ideal of you better be this or you're nobody. It's more of here's your North Star that you should be striving to become over your lifetime.
As you share that powerful insight, it reminds me of something we talked about before air, and you used the term complementarianism, that in marriage, there's certain roles that if the man does this, the woman does this, God's ordained all of this.
Yeah.
That's when it works.
Yeah. For sure, there's egalitarianism as it relates to the male and female standing before God. They're both of equal value and equal worth, but they have different roles that are complementary. And so when you see what the scriptural role is for the woman in marriage and what the scriptural role is for the male in marriage, you can see how they fit together. And if both spouses stay in their lane and do what scripture says, they'll have much more of a synergy in their marriage and a productivity, a peacefulness, and a product more so than if they're scripturally out of their lane and maybe struggling with these issues. I have a grandson that's living with us, Frank, who's I just gave him Grudem's book. Grudem Piper wrote a book probably two decades ago now, if not three, called Rediscovering Biblical Manhood and Womanhood. And if any of our listeners want to do a deeper dive than our 8-page Bible study that they can get on our website at capmin.org, if they want more than what we're supplying, if they want 500 pages of theology on what is the lane for each biblically and see that exegetically from Genesis to Revelation written by different authors in this book. They're the general editors, Grudem and Piper. You're going to get a boatload of theology. And I would say anybody that's listening, contemplating marriage, ought to go through that with their spouse. That's what I have my grandson doing, so that you don't have to negotiate this after you walk the aisle, hoping you can change your spouse into what you think he or she should become. It's a lot more healthy to have a theology that you both agree with and discover before marriage and marriage counseling, so that you are on the same sheet of music when you do start singing a song together.
Here at Capital Ministries, we are aggressively recruiting volunteer Bible teachers to start discipleship ministries in the 40,000 local city and county governments across America. We provide the training, the Bible studies, the credentialing, and the ongoing encouragement to those individuals whom God is raising up for this overlooked but very important mission field. We need strong men who can teach Bible studies to their city council members, men who are disciple makers. Is that you or possibly someone you know? Go to capmin.org and click on the Ministry tab. Join a team of thousands who want to change the trajectory of America. Again, go to capmin.org, as in Capital Ministries. Who do you know who can be trained to do this in your city? Capmin.org. Welcome back. This is the Capital Ministries Weekend with Ralph Drollinger. Ralph is president and founder of Capital Ministries. We are talking about a Bible study Ralph will be doing in D.C. this week, even as we speak, entitled 10 Characteristics of a Godly Woman. My name is Frank Sontag. We're thrilled to be on your radio station. Thank you for listening. And go to capmin.org to not only download this study, to find out more about what we do, and get involved. We'll share maybe in a moment about, we'll ask you to maybe consider being a local government ministry leader, what that means. But I want to get back to the study at hand here on 10 Characteristics of a Godly Woman. Ralph, before the break, you had mentioned your grandson, and he's kind of contemplating marriage, and you mentioned the Grudem Piper book. for anybody listening right now that may be in a marriage and they're up against it with all the pressures of culture and everything that's going on, what would you tell them about not only you and Danielle have been together for more than 3 decades, but just the inherent truth of the Bible and how all the answers are in God's word as it applies to this and any other institution for that matter?
Yeah, I mean, loosely, it's an owner's manual. And when you read the owner's manual and you can figure it out, the instructions it gives you, you're going to have a lot more success driving your car of marriage than if you never read the owner's manual, especially when you live in today's age where in that automobile there's 17 different chips and you don't know how to operate the darn thing.
Great analogy.
And so
how do I start my car?
That's right. I got this new truck that the ministry bought me and I still haven't figured out all this stuff in it. Yeah. And so that's how I think marriage is in today's difficult climate of woke moralism, where you just don't understand unless you have a really good theology from scripture to base your marriage on, you're going to be really up for a big climb.
Is this a popular study in D.C.? Is this a popular study overall?
It's interesting, Frank, that this is the number one downloaded study from the CapMin website. And I don't know if that's guys downloading it to give to their wife.
Honey, you need to read this. And then we need to read it together.
Or if it's, I don't know who's downloading it, but every week it comes up number one. I can't quite understand it.
Wow. We have a few moments. I want to ask you at the end to share a word of hope, but the end of the study, you get into the bad babes.
Yeah, the 8 bad babes of the Bible.
Do we want to mention that at all?
Maybe we should just water ski over the top of those.
Okay.
You do see if you just parachute in on different passages of scripture, you're not going to find one passage that mentions all these ladies like you have the Saints Hall of Faith in Hebrews. You're not going to see the bad babes of the Bible in one chapter of the scripture. But suffice to say, there's the woman at the well. She's had 5 husbands. She's a bad babe of scripture.
Yes.
You have Adam's wife. She's the deceivable woman. We'll find out in a minute there's this deceiving woman, but there's also the deceivable. So we could say that Adam's wife, Eve, was deceivable by Satan, obviously. You see Lot's wife. She's the materialistic woman. It's just a quip in Genesis where she looks back and she's basically saying, if you read into the passage, and I don't think it's a misread into the passage, that she's basically saying to her husband, we had such a nice place in Sodom and now you're making us leave. Can I just look at the yard once more before we leave? And she got saltified. And then you've got the contentious woman, David's wife. You've got the corrupting woman, which is Ahab's wife. You've got the discouraging woman, which is Job's wife. What'd she say to Job? Just curse God and die, dude.
I don't think we can find that necessarily in scripture along the lines of, like, specifically she said that, but okay.
She does say that. Curse God and die.
Wow.
And then you got Potiphar's wife, and she's manipulative. Remember, she's trying to catch Joseph and Joseph has the first tearaway jersey.
Yeah, that's right.
The NFL didn't come up with that. Joseph already had one on. And then you've got Ananias's wife, who's the deceitful woman in Acts chapter 5. You know, they're lying to everybody about their great virtuous giving when they're really not.
So we've had kind of a good laugh here near the end. And I think sometimes humor is of the essence. But when it comes to the institution of marriage, I think so many of us are struggling. So many of us are intentional. Like, we wanted to get married and we had this idealistic view of what this was, but yet God's ordained this. Let's get into the word. In the moment we have before I ask you maybe to share a bit of encouragement, I want to give you a moment to say a clarification, because in this broadcast, again, we've been laughing. There's people out there don't understand, maybe they're interested in becoming a follower of Christ. It's like these two guys are talking about how women are supposed to act. That's not what we're doing at all.
No,
we're talking about the importance of the Bible, and right. God's got all this in his word.
Yeah, I mean, to the tightest context, I teach guys in D.C. who are office holders, and I'm basically saying, hey, here's the book of Proverbs, and in chapter 31, it says, this is really the ideal political leader's wife.
Yes.
And so this has direct application relative to the high standard, the higher standard she should have as the wife of a leader in a nation. And of course, scripture is going to put a higher standard, just like relative to male leadership in the church in 1 Timothy 3 and in Titus chapter 1, you can see that there's basically a litmus test relative to the virtuous character of a male senior pastor in a church. It's not compromisable. And so that's the big idea here. And so when we look at this passage, it's not necessarily applicable without any grace to the common listener as much as it is, here's the highest standard scripture gives, ideally.
This is the Capital Ministries Weekend with Ralph Trollinger. Ralph is president and founder of Capital Ministries. We've been talking about 10 characteristics of a godly woman, the Bible study that Ralph will be teaching in D.C. this week. You're welcome to follow along, download, go to capmin.org. Ralph, in the moment or two we have remaining, any encouragement, any, when we talk about marriage, my goodness, you look out, it's such a terrain of frustration, hopelessness, people are lost. What would you share with the listeners about the realities of marriage and specifically the Bible study that you have coming up, 10 characteristics of a godly woman? What would you say in closing?
Well, I would just say that we live in a tumultuous culture that's really messing up the foundations of our culture, and the solid rock bed theology of what a male is to be like and what a female is to be like as created in God's image. And we have the designer's owner's manual at our access. And so if we don't have an understanding of who we are in scripture relative to our being, and if we don't understand how he expects those two to become one, then it's going to be very difficult to build any kind of future marriage when there's disagreement on the basics. And so, like, you know, I played for Coach Wooden, and he wrote Fundamentals of Basketball, which are basically four things: shooting, dribbling, passing, and rebounding. And so we did drills on that for 4 years, 2 hours a day on just those four things. And those are the building blocks of a successful national championship team. We won, what, 10 championships in 12 years. Mm-hmm. And so if we don't have the foundations of marriage right in a nation, and marriage is the building block of a nation, then that nation's eventually not going to win many games because they just won't have the fundamentals of the culture down correctly. And when you try to redefine marriage, you're really messing with the whole construct of the nation.
Ralph, literally, we cannot thank you enough. I'm excited about what God's going to do with this radio program. And when we talk about godly women, godly men, what an honor to be in the studio with you and just listen to your words of wisdom and to read along in your Bible study that you will be doing this week. Happy Mother's Day. And
thank
we
you.
Pray for you this week in D.C. as you do this Bible study. And thank you for being on the program, and we thank the radio station for supporting us.
Amen. Always good to be with you, Frank.
Thank you. This is the Capital Ministries Weekend with Ralph Trollinger. Again, Ralph is president and founder of Capital Ministries. Go to capmin.org, find out how you can get more involved and support us. Until next week, my name is Frank Sontag. God bless you, and happy Mother's Day. Thank you for listening to this, the Capital Ministries Weekend with Ralph Trollinger. Will you help support the ongoing work of Capital Ministries today? Here at CapMin, we think it's time for a biblically based missions strategy to change the trajectory of America. For the past 50 years, we've worked to change the laws of the land rather than the hearts of the lawmakers. What's resulted is a country in continual decline. Rather than try and get politicians who reject the author of Scripture to accept the precepts of his book, let us instead place our best disciple makers and evangelists in the seats of governmental leaders. We'll start ministries in city halls, state capitals, and federal capitals in America and throughout the world. Let us win and build public servants for Christ. Go to capmin.org today and give. Together, let us make disciples of Jesus Christ in the political arena, here in America and throughout the world.